Hi, I'm Larry Dignan. I'm here for Now What, and we're doing a panel on what the future of work looks like and the new normal. We have Shannon LaPierre. She is Chief Communication Officer for Black & Decker. Glenn Sanford, he is CEO of eXp Realty. And Christine Tradella from Facebook Workplace. Hi, guys. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
Thanks, Larry. Thanks, everyone.
So let's just kick off with, 90 seconds or so on kind of what you've learned from moving your teams remote and sort of what the state of play is now, in the post-COVID world. And I guess just give me a few takeaways, then we'll go from there. Shannon, you want to kick off?
Sure. So I am with Stanley Black & Decker. We have about 60,000 employees around the globe. About half of them are in manufacturing environments, half in an office environment. When the COVID virus hit in the U.S. and in this region, we quickly moved basically every office worker that could work remote, we moved to virtual work. And that was a big shift for us. We're a 177-year-old industrial manufacturing company headquartered in New Britain, Connecticut. So fairly traditional organization. So it's been a big move for us. We did that in part so we could really focus on keeping our manufacturing operations open and keep those employees healthy and safe, and put a lot of effort into keeping our manufacturing plant operations and distribution centers safe for our employees, and sent the office workers home to really help mitigate the work that would be required to keep all 60,000 employees in that environment safe. So it's really been a great learning experience for our company. Again, very traditional company. And I think the biggest thing we learned that it was a lot easier for us to send home our office workers to work virtually than we expected. So when we talked about doing it, there was a lot of consternation about whether or not we could operate that way for any extended period of time, like 5 days. But here we are, several months later. And in many ways, we found it to be more productive than when folks were in the office together.
And Glenn, how's it worked for you? I know your team was largely remote before.
Yeah, so I'm founder of eXp World Holdings, which is the parent company of eXp Realty, actually a company I founded in 2009. But we're 29,000 plus real estate agents, brokers, and staff operating in all 50 US states, most of Canada, UK, Australia. But we've been operating 100% remote literally from the day we started back in 2009. For that part of the business, it hasn't really missed a beat. We did have to, unfortunately, let go of a few staff just because the transaction counts were lower. But in terms of actually our day-to-day actually ended up being the same. And we've kind of looked at it as being one of the benefits now is that people are actually starting to see all the things that we were seeing running entirely remote. Another company that we have is a company called Virbela, which is actually our virtual world for work platform. And that team, ironically, wasn't all working from home until COVID. Now they're all working remote. And we're similar, seeing production increase and engagement increase. And just the way that we're working together is actually been a blessing in terms of being able to be more engaged with people because we're now all 100% remote.
Christine?
Yeah, so at Facebook, it's been really interesting because the majority of our employees work in any one of our many offices around the world, but moving to remote work was pretty seamless for us. I mean, we have a lot of the tools and ways to communicate effectively that have allowed us to be just as productive, if not more productive, now working remotely. I think personally, I lead the Workplace from Facebook team in the Americas, and we have this really unique vantage point of being able to see how other companies and businesses and organizations are, adapting to this this new normal as a result of COVID and having to enable remote work. Workplace is a communication and collaboration platform for businesses, enterprises, organizations, and it's been really interesting to see just the usage really increase with those customers that are already Workplace customers, and then just a real increase in demand from other enterprises and organizations that need a way to engage employees and facilitate a sense of community, even though people are not physically together in the workplace anymore.
So as the panel looks forward, the thing that struck me about all the remote work is just sort of the difference between a frontline worker that would be deemed essential versus, you know, a knowledge worker who, you know, from what I can tell, most of them have been able to go remote without a lot of productivity lost. I guess, Shannon, what's the role of the frontline worker in this, you know, going forward? Like how more connected do they need to be? And, you know, can some of those roles turn into remote roles?
I think there's a shift in two categories in that space. One is when I think about our frontline salespeople and people who are out visiting customers and making sales calls, and some of our technicians, where some of them have adapted to remote work or partially remote work. And they've been doing a great job of leveraging tools and using Workplace for communicating internally, and also reaching out to customers and doing tutorials virtually and things that they would have had to have done in person, or things that they wouldn't have ever kind of gotten to in the scale of the demands of the day. And they've been using that to really reach out to customers in new and different ways and make sales even without that in-person contact. I think for our frontline workers that are in our plants, in our distribution, our manufacturing centers, obviously, you know, they need to be in those factories in order to produce the products and manufacture. And I think what we've seen in this global pandemic world is how essential those workers are to keeping our world running. So several years ago, we launched our purpose for those who make the world, which was really about both our customers as well as our employees who are out there in doing the hard work every day to make our world a better place. So they're building our buildings, they are working with our healthcare workers, they are constructing, building, making, creating, craftsmen, caregivers, and those people out on the front lines every day. We think about nurses and doctors, but there's also those people who are out building our roads and constructing bridges that are essential to our environment and in our community and our livelihood. And so what I think is great about this situation, if we can find any kind of bright lights, is that it's really brought to the front how important these workers are to our society.
And most of these workers were sort of distanced from the culture of the company traditionally anyway, right? So I guess what are you doing to kind of bring them into the fold in terms of culture and making them feel, you know, kind of more in line with the corporate culture?
We've been doing a lot to let those workers know that we care about them and reach out to them. And really a lot of the messages and the work has been focused on ensuring a safe work environment and providing that safety and the training that they need to keep themselves healthy and keep the plant operating. So, you know, in the past, as you mentioned, they may have not been as connected in. I think now more than ever, these are the employees that need to know that the company cares about them and values them, and that people value and care about them. So we've been doing a lot of work in that space and really recognizing, you know, our employee heroes that have really been going above and beyond to keep the company running and to keep our customers running during this very difficult time period. So these are products and services that are used by maintenance people in hospitals, for healthcare workers, and for first responders that need these tools and services to do their jobs.
So just to zero in on that, the sales stuff that Shannon mentioned, Glenn, how has the sales process changed for Realty, you know, during this crisis, and how do you see it evolving over time? I mean, I've been watching Zillow very closely, and, you know, their 3D tours and a bunch of other things. I guess, what's the sales process look like in the new normal?
Yeah, so something we've seen quite a bit, and our real estate professionals, they've been out still listing homes and helping buyers buy homes. But what we are seeing is that our agents are socially distancing as much as humanly possible, which may mean having the home seller actually take photos of homes before they actually get listed. So they'll actually do some of the work where maybe we would have had a professional photographer come out, or if the agent themselves is a photographer, they may have been going out and doing the listing. So we've seen entire listings actually put together without the agent and the seller getting together, but the agent's still walking the seller through the process. But we're also seeing on the buyer side very similar type of activities where agents are co-browsing listings, walking through 3D virtual tours with their consumer, gathering the information from prospective listings and making sure that that's organized for the buyer, so that the buyer ultimately is either physically looking at the fewest number of homes possible, or to in some cases we've had buyers literally buy sight unseen because they felt that they had gathered enough information to actually complete the real estate transaction, and they're still in some cases waiting to actually move in because they're not quite at the point where they can sort of make that transition, but they've actually went through the whole home buying process. So we've seen some of that. Other markets, it's not, it hasn't been that stringent, but in some markets, you know, real estate agents haven't really had the ability to physically go and do a lot of things. And so they've just had to figure out how to adapt to the new normal.
So Christine, what are some of the things you're seeing on the platform in terms of, you know, frontline worker engagement, how it's being used? I guess what have you seen over, you know, the last 6 or 7 weeks? And, you know, more importantly, do you think that kind of level of collaboration will continue, or will it phase out as people go back to the office?
Yeah, well, connecting the frontline back to the home office is really part of our mission at Workplace. I mean, 80% of the global workforce is considered a frontline worker. And so when you think about creating a community, engaging employees, and being able to reach and connect every single employee in an organization, it's really critical to connect the frontline. And to Shannon's comments, you know, they are most critical workers right now in many aspects. We've seen a lot, and we've seen really strong engagement again from customers that are using our platform right now as the corporate knowledge workers are in their homes and the frontline workers are still out in the field. We're seeing a lot of executives actually use this time to connect and do live video to be able to connect with everybody within the organization. And what's been really interesting to see is just how humanizing this has been. I mean, at again, a time of real uncertainty, probably high anxiety for some people, being able to have executives come and speak to an entire organization, have a two-way dialogue, be able to answer questions, see them in their homes with their children, their families, maybe not in traditional suits and ties, but in more you know, comfortable clothing, has really humanized them at a time when it's been really critical and people have needed that. And being able to do that to an entire company and not just within the hallways or certain meetings has been really a great thing for us to see and experience through the eyes of the people that are using Workplace right now to connect company-wide.
So open question for anyone who wants to answer, but, you know, out of the technologies that have been adopted so far, right? So if you look at, you know, companies with digital transformation efforts seem to have done better in the crisis. But, you know, I think we're entering a period where we're going to be tweaking a lot of the new normal, probably for the few months to come at least. What technologies are we using now? And what do you think will stick? And then what are some loose ends that we'll need in the future?
Well, certainly for us, you know, our use of Workplace has been hugely impactful on our ability to stay connected as an organization throughout this whole period. We've done, we do a lot of video coming out of our virtual meeting environment, and we'll literally broadcast that to multiple channels at the same time. I think we've got four events live going on right now in our virtual world, and we're streaming it to various channels on Workplace so that we can all be engaged and see that content in real time. And so the ability to sort of be you know, present in a place, I think is really important. And so for us, you know, we've been we've been using a platform for 6 years now to actually create a sense of place in addition to the workplace environment. And that's been a really great 1-2 punch for us to be able to be fully engaged. And with that, with what's going on with the pandemic, what we've done is we've shifted to more classes, more places to engage online because our agents and brokers aren't able to be out in the field as much. So we're really lifting the game from an educational standpoint. So we're using more tools on that as well. So using polling, using a lot of ways to sort of gather content from our team that can't go and do the normal activities of real estate has been sort of key to keeping everybody sort of connected in real time.
So what does your collaboration stack look like now? I mean, obviously you have Workplace, you have your virtual platform. What are some of the other tools you're using?
Yeah, so our platforms right now, the way that I look at it is certainly Workplace and then Virbela, that's the virtual world for work platform that we use. We're big users of Trello, which again integrates so well with both tools quite well. We're also use a lot of G Suite collaborative docs, collaborative spreadsheets, doing a lot of things where we're working together on documents. The other thing that we're spending a little bit more time on is actually mapping out what I call mapping out the remote organization. And we're using a tool right now called HoloSpirit, and that's kind of a unique kind of a niche-y platform, but it's allowing us to really figure out who does what work and what work are they doing, and we're sort of organizing that. So sort of between all of those tools, we're able to really track about 90-95% of all the work that gets done in the organization can be tracked through those platforms.
So Shannon, what do you have today versus what you kind of want tomorrow?
We've been an early Workplace adopter, so we've been using Workplace for about 3 years, and our leadership team and our CEO have been big advocates. So it really took off several years ago, but there are many days where we couldn't imagine what our work world would be like right now from a communications perspective if we didn't have that in place. So we use that as our central repository for our teams, for sharing information, for directing folks, and housing some of our key safety information that is just critically important right now. And what's really interesting, and one of the things we loved about Workplace when we first launched it, is we're a global company, so we have employees in 60 countries around the world. And to be able to wake up in the morning and for us to look at a DeWalt store set up in Korea, for example, and be able to look at the brands and the positioning and be able to see what's happening around the globe like that in real time was just something we had never really imagined being able to do before. So it was really exciting for us. But now when we look at this environment, it applies to things like safety timeouts. So our operations team did a global safety timeout in our plants around the globe. And each of those teams posted photos of the safety timeout happening real time in their plant, socially distant. And we were able to see that. So in past lives, you might have had a situation where people would tell you, oh yeah, we did the timeout, but we actually get to see that the timeout happened. And that's something that is really priceless to us right now. And it allows us to also recognize the plant managers that are doing all the safety techniques that we're encouraging them to do and sharing that information across the globe, sharing learnings of best practices. We experienced a lot of challenges several months ago, back in January with the pandemic with our plants in China. And now those learnings are getting shared from China across Europe into Asia, other parts of Asia, and into the US and North America. And so it's been a way for folks to communicate visually, pictures, to share that information. We're of course using it for executive video content, and that engagement with the comments section has been amazing to watch. And again, with employees around the globe. So we now have employees engaging at the executive level, particularly now in this crisis when people are really looking for that connection, they're looking for reassurance and confidence. And we're having people engage that normally would never have even bothered to be on the platform, or it would do it minimally, but now they're engaging and commenting. So it's been really interesting to watch how people have adapted there. Like many of us, we're big Zoom users as well. And what's interesting is thankfully our IT team had launched Zooms several months ago across the enterprise. We were using kind of various platforms before, and everyone quickly adapted to Zoom. The first few kind of executive leadership calls were a little challenged. Everyone's trying to find the mute button and the video button, and people are talking while they're on mute. But it was amazing to see how quickly even our executive leadership team adapted into that process and using video and doing these calls. So it's been pretty transformative.
How much does what happens internationally inform how you guys operate in the States? And I guess how fast is that information? Like you mentioned a store in Korea, you know, with the new platforms you guys are using and sort of the collaboration, how it's been, you know, revved up a good bit. How fast does what happens in Korea or China inform, you know, what happens in the US, and whether it's office design or safety techniques or anything like that? I guess how fast does things travel now?
So it's happening almost real time now. And I think that's one of the amazing things that Workplace has given us from a platform perspective, is our employees in China, and they were doing this before we were really even hit with the pandemic hard in the US. So they're posting, when they got back to reopening the plants there after the Lunar New Year holiday, they had to make a lot of safety adjustments in those plants. So they were temperature checking employees, everyone was wearing masks, they were setting up some kind of physical barrier in the lunchrooms for breaks and things like that. And so those photos were taken back then. And then as the pandemic has moved across the globe, we've been able to take those learnings and adapt them to plants here in the US. So they really are photographing best practices. They've got a special group on the in workplace where they're sharing those coronavirus best safety protocols and practices among the plant managers. And that's something that would be very difficult to do in another format. They can post and upload those, comment, share, and trade that information. And what's interesting is before the pandemic, that was happening a lot with the sales teams, for example, but we didn't have high plant leader engagement prior to the pandemic. And so those are things that we think are gonna continue, and being able to share those best practices. We have 30 plants across the US and probably about 100 or more around the globe. So you're talking about a pretty big operation that's tough to get aligned. And this is a way for our own plant managers to facilitate that among themselves too.
So Christine, going forward, how much work do you think stays remote versus becomes a physical presence? Or do you see it being, I guess, more hybrid? I mean, I know every industry is different, but everyone I've seen, you know, the two big themes from CFOs is, one, we don't need all this commercial real estate, and two, some percentage of work's gonna stay remote. I guess, how do you see it developing over time?
Well, that's a great question. It's a $64,000 question. I don't know that I have a crisp, clean prediction for you. I will tell you, this is clearly going to be an inflection point. And my hope is that it's an inflection point more around the philosophy around working from home, less around the logistics of doing so. I think people have proven that they can be productive. I think that people have been vocal about the fact that they want options, that they, you know, are finding more work-life balance, that they're feeling more rested, they're having more time with their family. And while, of course, nobody wants this pandemic to have happened or to continue, I think it's really teasing out of a lot of employees that they want the options, they want the ability to be able to work from home, and that they've proved that they can be productive in doing so. I think the real key thing is going to be, again, making sure that there's a way to facilitate employee engagement, that there's a way to build community, even if everybody isn't centralized physically in one office or a series of offices. And, you know, again, coming into this pandemic, we found a lot of companies were prepared in terms of people having either, you know, laptops and phones and email, but there really weren't tools to collaborate and ultimately build that sense of community across an organization. And I think coming out of this, that's going to be really critical for companies moving forward.
And this is a question just for anyone on the panel. What has to happen on the home office side? I just lucked out and happened to upgrade my Wi-Fi router in January. But if I didn't have that, I'd probably be smashing my head into a wall right now. Everything from desk chairs to laptops to screens, I mean, it's a massive upgrade process for, you know, anybody suddenly working remote. What has to happen on the home office side to sort of connect better to the corporation?
I think one of the things, and I've just done this myself, partially because of the amount of times I'm doing Zoom meetings as well, is just to figure out what's my backdrop look like. So, you know, prior to this, I was working from home, but wasn't doing the Zoom or the video conferencing that often. And so, you know, figuring out where's that safe space inside of your home is really a key component to be effective. I think one of the things that we've noticed over the years, because we've been doing fully remote for a long time, is that there's also an acceptance that you're going to hear other sounds in the background that are not typically work related. You know, the kids, you know, that come running in and asking a quick question, or the lawnmower that gets going off in the backyard, that becomes a more of a normal nuance that you just have to sort of accept that these things are going to happen when you adopt more remote work first approaches. So for us, that's been something that I've noted, is that you're going to have a safe space, especially if you're going to be using a lot of video. If you can get away with not using a lot of video, then I think you've got a lot more options of where you can work from.
So do you think that's going to impact how homes are chosen and bought and sold? Like, is the home office going to be, you know, your three bedrooms going to be some kind of loft or something?
Yeah, it may very well be a more central feature for individuals. But I think I think employers are also going to need to recognize that, you know, individuals are going to need to invest a little bit more in their home. And so maybe there's a little bit of the cost savings goes to setting up and maintaining a home office that might be part of the budget processes. Do you have a good home office? If you don't, you know, maybe start looking if you're going to be a fully remote organization or even a partially remote organization. What does that look like?
What do you think, Shannon?
I think your point, Larry, about the infrastructure and the technology and the Wi-Fi capabilities, all that is going to be critically important. There are populations and regions where they just don't have good access. So we have teams where most people have good access and it works, but others just don't still, even in 2020. The other piece is about people's right now. People have a lot going on in their homes. And so when you look forward, ideally at some point the children will get back to school and maybe the spouse or partner will get out to work. That will make working remote and working from home a little more seamless. I think we find a lot of employees have a lot of challenges around that, just finding that quiet space in a home or an apartment, which, you know, was not bought or designed to have 1, 2, 3, or 6 people in it all day long, doing schoolwork, doing Zoom calls, and you might have, you know, 3 to 6 people in your home trying to use that same bandwidth every day. And I think that's where a lot of our employees are running into challenges right now. So even if they might want to work from home longer term, you know, some of those changes would have to happen to make it something that would work for them. The thing that I've loved that Glenn pointed out, I think one of those real benefits has been getting to know people's families and their pets and their dogs and, you know, getting a peek into people's homes. And we've found that we've had a lot more tighter connections in with a lot of our teams in ways that we might not have expected, where traditionally a lot of people try to keep their personal life kind of away from their work life or not really divulge everything about themselves. And suddenly we're finding ourselves kind of almost in each other's homes virtually for the first time. And there's a kind of cool factor about that. And we've had a few folks in our company and team schedule virtual social hours and virtual team chats. And a woman on our team scheduled a virtual scavenger hunt for our team. And every week she has us put a different backdrop on. So, you know, this week was your favorite movie. Last week it was Transformation Tuesday. So you had to post an old photo of yourself and talk about it. And so, you know, we're connecting in ways that we just would never have expected, and getting to know each other in a different way than we otherwise would have had an opportunity to do so. So again, if there's just a few bright lights in this really, really tragic period we're living in, those would be a few of them.
So final question, we'll start with you, Christine. What's keeping you up at night about the new normal?
Well, a lot is keeping me up at night. This is clearly a period of high anxiety. I think, You know, again, I really hope that this is an opportunity for, as we work through this, for companies to listen to their employees and really, again, look at the productivity that was, you know, achieved during this time and really start to empower their employees, trust their employees to make the decision as to whether or not they are more productive, happier, more well-rested, you know, having better balance, happier and more engaged by working at home versus having to be in a physical office. I think there's clearly, you know, as potentially people move away from the office and there is more remote work enabled, there is a, you know, kind of downstream economic impact that can happen to stores, restaurants, transportation that is, you know, really powering that ecosystem of a, you know, a high density office area. But again, my hope is that, you know, companies recognize this and recognize what, you know, what this has done for employee productivity and thus engagement and that they continue to look at this as an opportunity for folks moving forward.
Glenn, what's keeping you up at night?
Yeah, I think mainly it's really the economy. You know, getting the economy going again is probably the thing that really has my attention because, you know, it's taken such a fast a downturn in terms of just, you know, layoffs and all the other impacts there. Because we've already been sort of operating this way literally since inception, you know, it's the, how do we get people back to work? How do we get them back on the team as quickly as possible? Where are those opportunities that we can scale? And of course, working remote does have certain advantages that you don't have to have them go to a specific location. So I think there's some benefits, but I think the idea of, you know, where are the opportunities given the significant slowdown in the overall economy, I think is the thing that really keeps me sort of thinking, where do we pivot next? How do we pivot? And I think there's going to be this continual incremental iterative pivoting that's going to take place over the next month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, because we don't know exactly when states are going to open up, when cities will be fully functional, and in our case, you know, when we can be fully operational at the same type of scale as we were as a real estate brokerage previously.
Shannon, final word?
I think about inclusivity. So organizations have worked really hard on improving diversity and being inclusive. And another benefit that's come out of this situation with more Zoom calls and workplace calls is you've in some ways put people on a more level playing field where, you know, it's not about kind of who has the bigger office or who's in charge. You know, we're all on the same size on a Zoom screen, right? And I think we all have the same access in a workplace environment. And I think the technology and the way people are working has really changed all that. And we've seen a lot of benefits on kind of equality and voices being heard. And so I do worry with some of the changes that are happening and are likely to happen that, you know, we could potentially see more impact on women, young families, as well as older workers who, when people bring people back to the workplace, you know, some of those older workers are still being advised, you know, at 65 or over to maintain social distancing and stay at home. And kind of what does that mean for their career pathing? What does it mean for moms and young parents who don't have childcare and daycare and how that pans out, as well as how this pandemic is really impacting the frontline workers and impacting much harder folks that on the lower end of the poverty scale. And so I think we need to think about all of that and where we find some sense of equality and inclusiveness as we move forward coming out of this pandemic, because we really don't want to have situations where we have large parts of our population that are just disenfranchised and not part of the solution and not part of how we go forward. And that piece worries me quite a bit. And I know we're going to have a lot of thoughtful leaders that are going to put a lot of time and effort into really thinking about that. And that's what my hope is for.
Great points, everyone. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.